Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. My name is Professor Richa Tanwar. I am Director of the Women's Studies Research Center at Kurukshetra University, Kurukshetra. Today I am going to discuss about patriarchy, rise of patriarchy and subversion of matriarchal ethos in Indian society, femininity, masculinity and the sexual division of labor. Before we study this module, you are expected to have the basic knowledge of the Indian social structure. The objectives of this module are to make you understand the concept of patriarchy and the process through which it operates in society with special reference to India. Meaning of patriarchy. In most of the societies in the world, men have dominated as decision makers within families as well as in various public spaces. The literal meaning of patriarchy lies in the principle of the domination by senior males over others, male as well as female, in the family, tribe or nation, along with the running of descent through the male line. Over time, this principle of seniority was increasingly substituted in the feminist discourse by an emphasis on control or power of men over women in the family and larger society, specified primarily as control over their productive and reproductive activities. Volbe, in 2010, she defined patriarchy as a system of social structures and practices in which men dominate, oppress, and exploit women. Hartman, in 1981, defined patriarchy as a set of social relations between men which have a material base and which, through hierarchical established or create interdependence or solidarity among men that enable them to dominate women. Patriarchy represents a social and cultural system in which all the material resources, for example, land, property, etc., are owned and controlled by the senior male who is the head of the family. And by virtue of that, he enjoys control over all productive and even reproductive behavior of women in the family. Patriarchy is reflected in societies in multiple ways. It gets nourished through the stereotyping that takes place during the process of socialization, whereby right from the time of birth, a child is trained to acquire a gendered behavior, vocabulary and body language that go with the cultural values and norms in a particular society. Patriarchy represents a social and cultural system in which all the material resources, for example, land, property, etc., are owned and controlled by the senior male who is the head of the family. And by virtue of that, he enjoys control over all productive and even reproductive behavior of women in the family. Patriarchy is reflected in societies in multiple ways. It gets nourished through the stereotyping that takes place during the process of socialization, whereby right from the birth, a child is trained to acquire a gendered behavior, vocabulary and body language that go with the cultural values and norms in a particular society. Patriarchy has by and large been treated to have contributed tremendously towards the subjugation of women in both private as well as in public domains. Cultural norms in most of the societies of the world are characterized by patriarchy. That is, domination of men in decision-making positions and subordination of women. This has often led to defining the work performed by men as more important, productive, and valuable in comparison to the work done by women. Patriarchy is often cited as the main reason why even economic independence among women has failed to grant them freedom and equal status with men. Patriarchy is therefore an ideology which legitimizes the domination of men over women in all spheres of life, thereby making a larger share of resources available to men at the cost of women. It begins within the private domain of family, extending beyond the familial boundaries to the public life and the workplace. Thus, patriarchal structures characterize even the economic, political, and religious organizations where men are the decision makers and at the helm of affairs, while women are placed at the bottom of the power hierarchy. In India, for example, all the major political parties are patriarchal in the sense that barring a handful of women are headed by men. All religious organizations are headed by men to an extent that at some places of worship, women are even debarred from entering. Is of patriarchy. In her book, Theorizing Patriarchy, Wolbe, in 1990, presents a theory for understanding the patriarchal system and its association with capitalism. She argues that patriarchy is made up of six structures: paid work, household production, culture, sexuality, violence, and state. In her earlier work, Theorizing Patriarchy, Wolbe presents a theory for understanding the patriarchal system. In her later work, Gender Transformation, in 1996, Wolbe further investigated the changes that had occurred in gender relations in the last half of the 20th century. She argued that Western societies have moved from a system of private patriarchy to public patriarchy. By that, she implies that till mid-20th century, women's lives were mostly controlled and restrained by men within their immediate family. Women were dependent on fathers before marriage and on husbands afterwards. After World War II, patriarchal domination of women got operated in the public world of work and politics. Although more women have become economically independent and do not require men's support to survive, yet the crucial decisions regarding their lives continue to be taken by men around. While private patriarchy kept them under the subordination of men in domestic lives, public patriarchy keeps women segregated at workplaces, at lower levels of hierarchy, while it is men at the powerful positions who make policies for them and control them in public sphere. Wolbe argues that gradually more women tend to be governed by public patriarchy, since more of them would be getting education and making entry into the workforce. Interestingly, both kinds of patriarchy affect women differently depending upon their age, income, religion, position in life, course, and so on. Talking about the rise of patriarchy, Holmes in 2009 argues that as the Western society entered the modern era, the increasing complexity of society saw distinctions made between different parts of people's everyday lives. A key distinction was between those areas of life through private and those thought public. Nature, rather than reason, was thought to govern the bodily and emotional messiness of relationships. Women were thought to be closer to nature and thus suited to tasks within the private sphere. The messiness of women's bodies was supposed to make them incapable of the reason needed for proper political debate, and so they were actively excluded from public decision making. For example, they did not have the right to vote till the late 19th century. While tracing the rise of patriarchy with capitalism, Wolbe in 1994 argued that patriarchy is an articulation with capitalism, and the state should be seen as both patriarchal and capitalist. She builds her argument by saying that the state acts to support patriarchal relations in a variety of ways, which include the limiting of women's access to paid work, the criminalization of forms of fertility control, support for the institution of marriage through the cohabitation rule, etc. During the 19th and early 20th century, many men began to insist that their wives should stay at home and not take work outside. Women's going out to work was considered to be a blot on the masculinity of their men. Therefore, as various studies have shown, as soon as a family experienced upward economic mobility, it would withdraw its women from work. Further, women had never been participating in decision-making process within as well as outside families. The public spaces, for example, the panchayat, marketplaces, public transport, administration, etc., have all been male spaces in which women had no place or role to play. Patriarchal structures actually grew stronger with the advent of industrialization and technological revolution. There has been a clear-cut domination of men over technological know-how and expertise. For centuries, barring a few women, men have been encouraged to study medicine, engineering, astronomy, mathematics, and politics, thus making the entry of men into these spheres easier, while women's reproductive capacity was often treated as their handicap. As narrated by Regge in 2003, for several decades, the standard anthropological definitions of patriarchy and matriarchy were derived from an essay written by Radcliffe Brown in 1924, The Mother's Brother in South Africa. According to Brown, a society may be called patriarchal when descent is patrilineal, that is, the children belong to the group of the father. Marriage is patrilocal, that is, the wife removed to the local group of the husband. Inheritance of property and success are in the male line. And the family is patripotestal, that is, the authority over the members of the family is in the hands of the father or his relatives. On the other hand, a society can be called matriarchal when descent, inheritance, and succession are in the female line. Marriage is matrilocal, the husband removing to the home of his wife, and when authority over children is wielded by the mother's relatives. Regge moves on to argue that this definition clearly indicates that familial authority in either system is expected to repose with the males. The father in the one, the maternal uncle or the other male relative on the mother's side in the other. According to Radcliffe Brown, there are no known empirical societies where women legitimately wield authority over men in the family and society. It's been quoted by Gold and Kolb in 1964. In other words, as the logical inverse of patriarchy, matriarchy is a myth. On the contrary, Kalanda in 1987 found significant regional variations in measures of what she calls wifely bargaining. Talking about the rise of patriarchy, Holmes in 2009 argues that as the Western society entered the modern era, the increasing complexity of society saw distinctions made between different parts of people's everyday lives. A key distinction was between those areas of life through private and those thought public. Nature, rather than reason, was thought to govern the bodily and emotional messiness of relationships. Women were thought to be closer to nature and thus suited to tasks within the private sphere. The messiness of women's bodies was supposed to make them incapable of the reason needed for proper political debate, and so they were actively excluded from public decision making. For example, they did not have the right to vote till the late 19th century. Anthropologists now agree that there is no evidence to substantiate the claim that any society has ever come under such control as cited by Gold and Kolb in 1964. Hence, sexual asymmetry in the exercise of power has been found to exist in the form of universal or near universal domination of men over women. Femininity and masculinity. Every society defines social roles on the basis of gender. In fact, since birth, a child is socialized according to the sex that he, she has. For instance, the color and types of dress is chosen on the basis of sex of the child. The toys are also selected on the basis of the sex. Right from the beginning, gender consciousness is reinforced in the child through the process of reward and punishment. Girls from the very childhood are encouraged and rewarded for internalizing the feminine traits. Example, submissiveness, emotiveness, tenderness, modesty, patience, and the like. Whereas boys are encouraged to be assertive, dominating, aggressive, competitive and ambitious. Anne Oakley in 1972 is a pioneer in exposing the social construction of gender in light of the huge cross-cultural variations across the world. She argues that people learn the normal ways to act feminine or masculine in their society through the process of socialization. Oakley argues that early socialization of children within the family is especially important in teaching people to act in ways thought appropriate for their gender. Further, the process of reward and punishment tend to reinforce the notions of masculinity and femininity among the young children. For instance, a boy is rewarded for displaying risk-taking, adventurous behavior, and dominance, while a girl is discouraged against such behaviors and vice versa. Masculinity and femininity are socially constructed. Are women born with femininity and men with masculinity? One could find many girls behaving like boys, wearing a hairstyle that is considered masculine, and dressing up like a boy. Similarly, it is not uncommon to see boys having a very delicate body, modest in their behavior, and with feminine characteristics. Actually, a boy with feminine traits is vulnerable to ridicule and sarcasm by his male and even female friends and relatives, and the same applies to a girl with masculine traits. Therefore, society, through reward and punishment, forces boys to grow as men and girls to grow as women. In relation to femininity, it is thought that women's traditional or natural role is as mothers. That women's natural role means not doing paid work can be challenged by looking at the women at the lowest end of income hierarchy. Feminine work has primarily been thought to include homemaking, child caring, mainly the domestic activities within the private sphere. Activities in the public sphere have been considered to be masculine. Further, women's body has been under the lens at all times. For a long time, masculinity and femininity were treated to be biological and thus naturally given to men and women. It is only after social anthropologists conducted extensive empirical studies across countries that it came to be realized that there are many societies in which the heavy and most strenuous work is performed by women, and as a result of that, they have muscular and hefty bodies, which may be considered as masculine in other societies. However, it is a fact that despite tremendous changes in the wake of industrialization and modernization, the notions of masculinity and femininity have refused to weaken. Rather, these have been reinforced. It is so difficult to dilute the notions of masculinity and femininity, which is reflected by the fact that despite the changed gender roles and entry of women in male-dominated professions, women's femininity has not been compromised. More women of all age groups are going to beauty parlors today to maintain their femininity. In some of the Southeast Asian countries, it has been reported that young girls working in the corporate sector are paid by their employers to go overseas in order to procure appropriate dresses and apparels to look attractive at their workplace. Further, young women have been increasingly going in for surgery in which, apart from flesh, muscles of thighs are removed to make these women look thin. After such a surgery, however, they are permanently not able to run or walk fast. Being expressive, emotional, altruistic, and patient are all considered as feminine traits which women are expected to possess irrespective of their profession or educational qualifications. Men, on the other hand, are encouraged to possess masculine characteristics such as an aggressive body language, ambitious career orientation, competitiveness, and so on. Sexual division of labor. Work and gender have always been closely associated in all societies. There are certain tasks which are known as masculine work and others as feminine. It is usually recognized that the contemporary urban family household is constituted by a division of labor that defines certain kinds of work as domestic, unpaid, and usually women's, and other kinds of work as public, paid, and usually as men's. Child rearing and caring, washing, cooking, etc. are considered primarily as women's work all over the world, while work outside home in public spaces is considered to be men's work. There has been an enormous change in the division of labor in the recent past, so that women have started taking up the work which earlier was men's work, for example, shopping for grocery, operating the bank account, paid work. This kind of division of labor has another dimension too, in that societies place men's and women's work in a hierarchy, so that the tasks assigned to women are unproductive in that these do not bring any money, while men's work is productive because it brings in money to the family. Feminists have struggled hard to bring loads of invisible work performed by women round the clock under recognition by societies as productive work. The sexual division of labor has often been explained in terms of nature versus culture opposition, whereby it is argued that women are closer to nature while men are closer to culture. Pursuing the biological theory, they have been naturally designed for the activities of childbirth and childcare. Since women are confined to the domestic context as opposed to men who operate in the political and public domain of social life. A majority of men today are not hostile towards their wives going out to work. But in most households, it is the man's work that determines where the couple lives, how much of their lives are organized in the domain of work itself, what Connell calls gender regimes, or in Bradley's phrase, gendered work cultures, which are still firmly in place. Some kinds of tasks are considered as appropriate for women, and women are debarred from various types of occupations by informal barriers and norms. The advent of new forms of domestic technology, household appliances, and commercially produced services such as pre-prepared food, disposable nappies, and so on, has only partially reduced the amount of time women spend on domestic chores. Scholars agree that women's concern with childcare and domestic tasks blocks their opportunities for achieving equality with men in the workplace. Far more women in paid work are in part-time employment than men. Most part-time jobs are poorly paid and have low promotion prospects. These very factors push women back towards home, sustaining the sexual division of labor. In the end, to briefly summarize the module, patriarchy represents a social and cultural system in which all the material resources are owned and controlled by the senior male, who is the head of the family. It has contributed towards the subjugation of women in both private as well as in the public domain. Patriarchal structures grew stronger with the advent of industrialization and technological revolution. Every society defines social roles on the basis of gender. And society, through reward and punishment, forces boys to grow as men and girls to grow as women. Work and gender have always been very closely associated. There are certain tasks which are known as masculine work and others as feminine work. Feminists have struggled hard to bring the invisible work of women under recognition by society as productive work.